Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Dr. Mazli. First of all, I would like to thank all of you for coming this evening and representing the co-organizers and my alumni. I just would like to say this: when we were students, somehow we had to become leaders because there were just too few of us. And when we were leaders, we didn't know what to do as leaders because nobody taught us about leadership. But still, when we thought about it all over again, we did some amazing things. Okay. So I used to tell people, if I knew about leadership at that time, maybe I would have done, or most of us would have done 100 times more than what we did. And we really created a lot of trouble for many people. Okay, so that this journey, I would like to say that number one, leadership is a journey. Nobody ever stops improving in becoming a leader, and nobody should ever stop learning about leadership. Okay, and I came to know about this wisdom late in my life, and I'm very happy today to see a lot of young faces, and that gives us a lot of encouragement for the future of the Muslim Ummah. Okay, as I said, the journey began when we look at leadership. We find that the best research in leadership undoubtedly comes from the West, and being MIZ alumni, I would say that among the West, the Americans lead in this very important topic about leadership. And research in America is well known for something which other people may criticize, but that's the strength of leadership of research in America, which is about being quantitative. You know, they are very much dependent upon data. They say the data doesn't lie. Okay, and that brings us to the fact that after reading almost 30-40 books about leadership, I find that these two authors, Posner and Kuzes, are the best, in the sense that their research is very, very, very empirical. I know that maybe some of you who do research in social science in Malaysia, if you get 1,000 data points, yeah, you probably get a PhD. Okay, see, their research has got about 3 million data points. Okay, we are talking 3 million, 3 million data points, and it's ever increasing. And this is the 3 million that they use to describe what is the essence of leadership. So they say that based on empirical research done over 6 continents, covering different kinds of leadership, from project leaders to leaders of large organizations, from government, private sector, non-profit organizations, they say that the whole world believes that leadership is about 2 main factors. So they call it leadership is about credibility. And they say that credibility is about 2 main ingredients. One is called truthfulness. The other one is called honesty. That's why we like this, you know. See, one is about truthfulness, and the other one is about honesty. And when you take these two words and translate it into Arabic, truthfulness is called as-sidq, and honesty is called al-amana. And as-sidq wal amana are 2 basic characteristics of all the prophets. And in particular, our great prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was given the title as-sadiq al-amin, not by the Muslims, but by the Quraysh. And all of us know in that incident in which all the tribes of Quraysh were fighting about who should get the last honor. In the rebuilding of Kaaba, who should get the last honor to place the Hajarul Aswad to where it belonged? I think most of us know about the whole story. There was a flood in Mecca, and they wanted to rebuild the Kaaba. And since the Kaaba is something holy, the Quraysh were all of them idolaters. They agreed that, number one, the money that is to be used to build the Kaaba should be clean money. Cannot be money from prostitution, cannot be money from gambling, cannot be money from riba. Okay? So it has to be clean money. So even the idolaters believe that it has to be clean money. Okay? Then finally, when everything was in place, that's why they built it only three-quarter full. They didn't manage to build the Hijrul Ismail well because they didn't have enough money. They didn't have enough clean money to rebuild the Al-Hijrul Ismail. Then they were about to fight with each other until they all agreed, the next person who comes to our majlis, let him decide. And there appeared our great Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who at that time was not a prophet. And they said, here comes As-Sadiq Al-Amin. Here comes the one who is truthful and the one who is honest. So with that, we began to expand the question. Is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in terms of the leadership theories, models, principles of the West, only a Sadiq wal-Amin, or he's more than that? So we looked at the works by the Western scholars, and we decided to take the latest work by Kuzes and Posner. They wrote a book in 2010 called The 10 Truths of Leadership. See, leadership truths are about 5, 7 or 10. The most is 10. And there's a reason for taking these numbers, but they said, that's it, leadership, the 10 truths. So we took the 10 truths of leadership, and we tried to do something was new. Okay, what's new is that in late 2008, 2009, two researchers from Switzerland, and two researchers from Switzerland decided to write a book. And they said that we'll write a book on management. And they say that every year there are 1,000 books published on management, every year. So they said, we cannot publish this book in the same way. We have to publish it in a different way. So they decided on a collaborative model to publish a book. Okay, and this is the book called The Business Model Canvas. So that is one topic which I'm good at, not related to our session this evening. So I decided to copy this model. Can we write a book with many of us collaborating together? So I talked about this idea to my friend and also my teacher and a great scholar, Dr. Tariq Al-Suwaidan, and he said, this is a very innovative idea, you should start. So we started with our brothers and sisters from MISG. And so many of them gave ideas and different views about the book. And finally, I'm not the author, I'm the chief editor. Okay, so I edited the contents of the book, and we published the book on Apple, by the way, the most innovative company in the world. And we sell it in Apple iBook Store. So there's no printed version of the book except what you see today. So today, to honor those who attend, we decided to do a limited printed edition of the book. So this book talk about the 10 truths of leadership. I will not go through all the 10. I just want to highlight what I believe are the important things that we can learn and we can apply in our lives. See, number one is that many people want to be leaders. And many people are made leaders because they are given positions. Dean of a faculty, head of a department, you know. Maybe some of you become have posts in political parties, some of you ask people to vote for you, and then when you become leader, actually you don't know what to do. Okay. See, the first great truth of leadership is that leaders make a difference. Okay. See, leaders make a difference. Kuznets and Posner define leadership as leaders achieve extraordinary things in the organization. That's what leaders do. They don't do simple things. They do the difficult things. They do things that make a difference. So when you take this criteria that leaders makes a difference, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam definitely made a big difference in this world. Why? Because he is voted as the most influential man in history. Okay? And today we will not be discussing about him if it was not for him. That's how influential he is. Until today, we talk about the leadership of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So that's number one. So leaders make a difference. So if you're a leader, think about what is a big thing you can do for your organization. Okay? And if you're not a leader of an organization, at least you're a leader of a family. Think about what is a big thing you can do for your family. So that you don't raise a normal family, you raise a great family. Okay? Of course, if you're a leader of a company, then think about what is a big thing that you can do for your company. So that it is not a normal company, it is a great company. Okay? So that's the number one thing about leadership. It is about making a difference. So Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made a major difference in the whole world until today, and it will last until the hereafter. So too the other companions. Abu Bakr made a great difference. If not for Abu Bakr, we would not pay zakat today at all. Now, Abu Bakr fought those people not because they didn't pay zakat. They say that we used to pay zakat to the Prophet. Now the Prophet has passed away, so we will not pay zakat. So he said this understanding is wrong, and he fought them. The other companions disagreed with him. He said, no, we fight them. And he used to say, even if I fight them alone, I will go and fight them alone. That was when Omar al-Khattab said, when I saw Abu Bakr with such full conviction, I knew he was right. And then when Omar agreed with Abu Bakr, the whole companions agreed with them. And today we pay zakah. Otherwise we will not pay zakah. So they made a difference. So too with Omar and with Uthman and with Ali and so on and so forth. So if you study the great Muslim leaders, that's what they did. They made a difference for Islam and for the society and for the world at large. So I think that's one of the things that we need to highlight, especially for our young Muslim generation. You know, many of you may be student leaders, so be brave and do the big thing. Big thing is not just simply about changing governments, there are other many big things in life, you know. I think that's also one thing that we need to comment. Most of us think that leadership is political leadership, which is wrong. There's leadership in business. It's one of the greatest leaders in the world is Mother Teresa. See, Mother Teresa, what is unique about her as a leader? So Mother Teresa is unique because nobody ever quotes what Mother Teresa said. Do you remember any notable quotation from Mother Teresa? Because she didn't say anything. She just did things without saying anything. So all the things that are being said about Mother Teresa is what she did. وَقُلِ اعْمَلُوا فَسَيَرَى اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this, just do. God, the believers, will see what you do. Okay? So that's number one about leadership. See, the number two thing about leadership, which I find it exemplified by our Prophet in an amazing way. Okay? is the concept of being a visionary leader. Today, if you look at modern leadership, that's what people like to talk about. Leaders who are visionary. Okay. They talk about Martin Luther King. I have a dream. And the dream of Martin Luther King came true. Through a man by the name of Barack Obama. That a colored man will one day become the president of the United States of America. Okay. John F. Kennedy, America will put a man on the moon before the end of the decade. So that's what people like to quote about visionary leaders. You know. But when we look at how visionary the Prophet ﷺ was, it's amazing. Habab ibn al-Arad, which is one of the early Muslims, was a slave. And in Mecca, the slaves suffered indescribable forms of torture and torment. And one day he came to complain to the Prophet ﷺ. He said that, you know, O Prophet, please pray to God. The Prophet looked at him and said, you are very impatient. Before you, there were generations of people that believed, and then they were put in the sand, and they were sawn into two pieces. They remained steadfast. The Prophet ﷺ then said, one day will come when a woman will travel alone from Sana'a to Hadramaut, and she will not fear anyone except the wild beasts. So that is a vision. What is a vision? Vision is a mental picture of the future. And the Prophet ﷺ painted a mental picture of the future. That in the future, a woman will travel alone from Sana'a to Hadramaut, and she will not fear anyone except the wild beasts. Habab ibn al-Arad said, I lived to see that day when a woman traveled from Sana'a to Hadramaut and she didn't fear anyone except the wild beasts. So can you imagine, under torture and when they were a small number, he painted a great vision for the Muslim Ummah in the future. Then there was the other occasion in the Battle of Khandaq. In the Battle of Khandaq, we know that the Confederates were about 100,000 planning to invade Medina. The Prophet listened to the advice of Salman al-Farisi to build a trench around two parts of Medina. And in working to build the trench, they came across a big rock. And they couldn't break the rock with their spades or the tools or whatever they had. So they said to the Prophet, we couldn't break this rock. The Prophet said, leave it to me. So he came and hit the rock. In the first hit, he said, Allahu Akbar, the keys of Sham is in my hands. And then he hit it a second time, Allahu Akbar, the kingdom of Persia now it's in my hands. And he hit the rock a third time and said, Allahu Akbar, I can see we are there at the gates of Yemen. Under great difficulty, when they had very little food, they had very little to drink, they were working so hard, and when the companions told the Prophet about difficulties, he painted a vision of the future. And then there was another incident about a woman. The Prophet ﷺ told her, this is Ummu Harran, that one day the Muslims will attack the enemy through the sea. And that first group of Muslims will be the best martyrs. Ummu Harran said, O Prophet, pray that I will be one of them. And the Prophet said, yes, you are one of them. See, this is someone in Medina who has never traveled across a sea. And he created a vision that one day the Muslims will have a naval force. And through that naval force, they will conquer new lands. And Umm Haran was a lady. And she wanted to be one of the first, you know, as they say, one of the first ladies in a navy. Okay? In Malaysia, we call it Tentera Laut. Right? And the first expedition took place when they attacked the island of Cyprus. And she joined that expedition and she was martyred in the island of Cyprus. So again, it was a vision that the Prophet ﷺ created. Then to me, the greatest visionary statement of the Prophet ﷺ was when he said, لَتَفْتَحَنَّ الْقَسْطَنْطِنِيَةِ فَنِعْمَ الْأَمِيرُ أَمِيرُهَا وَنِعْمَ الْجَيْشِ ذَلِكَ الْجَيْشِ. He said, verily, Constantinople will be opened by the Muslims. فَنِعْمَ الْأَمِيرُ, and the best of the Amir will be that Amir. And the best of the soldiers will be that soldiers. The first attempt to conquer Constantinople took place in 62 Hijrah during the time of Muawiyah. And they did not succeed. They continued because it was a vision of the Prophet. A vision that really inspired the Muslims, because not only will we be able to give a strong statement against the most powerful Roman Empire, which is Christian Empire, which is the Romans. But those who are in that battle will be among the best of the soldiers. And the one who leads that, he'll be among the best of the leaders. So when did that happen? I'm sure all of you know, 1453 by Sultan Muhammad Al-Fatih. When he was a prince, Sultan Muhammad Al-Fatih, when he was a prince, there were many teachers, but he learned many things. But one teacher had this strange habit. When he finished his lessons with Muhammad Al-Fatih, he would ride with Muhammad Al-Fatih on the horse, and they will go to the shores of the Bosphorus. And sometimes they will go into the water of the Bosphorus. And he will repeat to Muhammad Al-Fatih, لَتَفْتَحَنَّ الْقَسْطَنْطِنِيَةِ وَنِعْمَ الْأَمِيرُ أَمِيرُهَا وَنِعْمَ الْجَيْشِ ذَلِكَ الْجَيْشِ. Okay. He was repainting the vision of the Prophet to Muhammad Al-Fatih. When he became the king of the Ottomans, the Sultan of the Ottomans, there was nothing more important to Muhammad Al-Fatih than the conquest of Constantinople. It is said that he refused to discuss any matter except how to conquer Constantinople. And that's what they did in 1453. And today all of us enjoy visiting the great city of Istanbul. But again, it was the vision of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So number one, leaders have great visions. And nobody had a greater vision than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody created among their followers someone who believed in the vision of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam compared to the Muslims, even though he mentioned it more than 14 centuries ago. And that vision about the conquest of Constantinople took 8 centuries for it to be realized. Then when we look at another truth about leadership, as mentioned by the Kuzes and Posner, he said leadership is about values. And that's what leaders are. Leaders believe in certain things. Some leaders believe in wrong things. Like Hitler, who believed in the supremacy of the Aryan race. But that was the thing that drove him. He really believed in the supremacy of the Aryan race. But the Prophet ﷺ excelled because he enshrined in terms of applying the best of the moral values, the best of the ethical values. the best of the societal values. Nobody believed in justice and was consistent with the values of justice than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody believed in the value of freedom and made sure that there is freedom more than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Freedom of religion, no compulsion in religion, all of these were values of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Honesty and all the great ethical values that we talk about. Today, if you study Western leadership, they talk mainly about values, but behavioral values, not ethical, moral, or societal values, because they know they cannot find a role model in moral, ethics, and societal values. They will find a lot of role models in behavioral values. Okay. So for example, one of my idols of leaders today is Sir Alex Ferguson. Okay, please, sorry for those who are on the wrong side. Okay, he believed in behavioral values. He believed in giving more than 100%. That's his behavioral value. Okay, that's what he believes in. But it is a behavioral value. It is not an ethical, moral, or societal value. But that's the best Western leaders can show today. Great examples of behavioral values. You give 120%, 130%. Okay? And see, by the way, if you want to understand what is giving more than 100%, if you are a sports fan, you watch the last 5 minutes of the game. If you watch the last 5 minutes of the game, and they're able to score two goals to make it a victory, or one goal to make it a draw, that's giving more than 100%. Okay? So, for those who follow football, that's the greatest value of Mr. Alex Ferguson. He believed, you want to play for him, give more than 100%. So anyhow, the Prophet ﷺ enshrined moral, ethical, societal values, justice, fight against oppression, and freedom, religious freedom, and so on and so forth. But in studying the leadership of the Prophet ﷺ, there's one thing that I was very surprised to find. Okay. I didn't expect to see this, which is one quality of leadership that if today you talk about Islamic leadership or Muslim leadership, you will probably not mention this. Kusas and Posner said this is a very important attribute of leadership, which means that leaders face challenges and they overcome challenges. But to overcome challenges, you need a very important attribute. You need to be creative and innovative. You need to be creative and you need to be innovative. That surprised me in the Prophet ﷺ, that he, after studying and looking back at many examples in the seerah, appeared to be a leader that strongly encouraged creativity, strongly encouraged innovation. If something has not been done before, he said, why not we do it? He took a great risk when he followed the advice of Salman al-Farisi to build trenches around the city of Medina. There is no guarantee it will work. But Salman said that this is how we do in Persia. And what did the Prophet say? This is something that the Arabs don't know. So he built the trench. When the 100,000 forces came, Abu Sufyan, the leader of the Quraysh and the leader of Al-Ahzab, who came to say, he said, this is a trench. We are Arabs, we don't know how to deal with trenches. So the Prophet ﷺ knew that the Arabs don't know how to deal with this. So it was an innovation. It is not an innovation in Iran or in Persia, but it was certainly an innovation in the land of Arabia. He took a major risk. So he, as the Prophet ﷺ, encouraged new ideas. He encouraged people to be creative. He encouraged people to be innovative. He may not be by himself creative or innovative, but definitely he encouraged creativity and innovation. And that characteristic continued in the time of Abu Bakr, continued in the time of Omar, continued in the time of Uthman, continued in the time of Ali. And that's why the Muslim Ummah became great, because our leaders were not only pious, they were not only honest, they were not only having moral values, but they were willing to do new things. Things that the Ummah didn't do before. They were willing to do all these new things. And that value of innovation and creativity is a major component of leadership that was exemplified by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So to end my presentation, I would say that maybe many of us ask this, you know, I'm not a leader, you know. Okay? So, but you are wrong if you say that you're not a leader. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'ulun 'an ra'iyati." All of you are shepherds. By the way, it's a beautiful, and the scholars said that shepherds in this hadith mean leaders. But leaders should behave like shepherds. Wa kullukum mas'ulun 'an ra'iyati. Ra'iyati ni, if translate in Malay, rakyat lah. Kan? See, the Prophet gave words that leaders, you take care of your rakyat. You take care of them. Like the shepherd, take care of the sheep. No shepherd kills the sheep. No shepherd bluffs the sheep. Okay? Yeah, no shepherd steals money from the sheep. See, وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْعُولٌ عَنْ رَأِيَةٍ. Okay? You are a leader. All of you are leaders. And you will be responsible for the people whom you are supposed to take care of. At least, in the least, we are leaders in our family. Leaders over our wife, over our children, and over our grandchildren. And therefore, leadership become a very, very important skill and attribute that we need to develop. And there cannot be a better leader than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you know, I mentioned this in the book, that the greatest weakness of leadership studies in the West, they are great in everything, but there's one thing that they don't have. Okay, they can talk about visionary leaders, they can talk about this, but they will always have many examples. Visionary leader, yes, John F. Kennedy, Martin Luther King. Leaders with morals, no, we cannot have John F. Kennedy because he had something to do with Marilyn Monroe. So, okay, so he's not a good leader in that side. Okay, we cannot have Martin Luther King as a thing because he's not innovative. Okay, so they have problems with that, but they have many good examples, but they will never have all the attributes of leadership in one man. And it is only that, you can only find that in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay. And that we think is our contribution to knowledge, that bridge between the steady empirical research in America, where we came from, and our history, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they have a great model proved by empirical research, but we have the real example. And when we merge them together, we see something that really beautiful that we can practice, and inshallah, hopefully improve our leadership capabilities. And I would like to end by sharing this study that me and my friend Dr. Tariq did. We looked at the Muslim Ummah and we said that, you know, there are five basic problems that the Muslim Ummah face. The first problem is that we are backward. Okay? Yeah, that's our first problem, we are backward. How to know that we're backward? Go to the mosque. Okay? And you go to the mosque, and you will be considered a great example. If you put your slippers on the right, okay, you are considered to be something, somebody great. If you take your slippers or your shoes and you put it on the shoe right, because everybody put their slippers and shoes anywhere they like. Okay? So that's how backward we are. And this is Malaysia. Don't tell me if you go to Yemen or you go to Mauritania, or then you can see how backward we are. Okay, so just to, I also like this example. You know, in Malaysia, you will find that somebody is driving, then he opens the window and throws rubbish out of the window. Then you follow him, he will go into the mosque. He will park the car, and then he'll become the imam. Okay? In the United States, where I come from, Ohio University, which is a party school, they party every weekend. So I stay in the apartment, and in the morning when I want to go for Fajr prayers, I will find that the trash can is full of beer cans. So these Americans, they are drunk, but they throw the beer can in the right place. They are drunk. They are really drunk, but they still remember how to throw the beer can in the right place. Okay, so this example how backward we are. All right. See, number two, we are ineffective. Okay, we are ineffective compared to the West. In many areas, we are ineffective. So, inefficient compared to them, and so on. Okay, so this another example. Third thing is that. Number one, we are backward. Number two, we are ineffective. But when we talk about it, we say that the root of the problem that face the Muslim Ummah are two. One is leadership. Okay, one is leadership. Really, in the Muslim Ummah, you can see today. You know, without trying to say about people, you see that if there is one good leader in the Muslim Ummah, he makes a big difference. Just one. Can you imagine if we have 5, 6, 10 of them? Today, you know, without saying many good things about him, we just take what is on the surface. You look at Turkey. Just one good example of a leader who wants to do something for the Muslim Ummah. See how much he can achieve. But it is only one. And even that, there is a lot of weaknesses in him and in them. Okay? So we said number one, leadership. Number two will be the fikrah. You know, do we understand Islam in the right way? Okay. So if we can focus on these two things, then we will be able to bring the Muslim Ummah in the proper direction. And that's why we say that we learn leadership very late in our lives. We don't want our young generation to make the same mistakes like us. So hopefully, the fact that they are keen on this topic of leadership and they become continuous students of leadership, they will become better leaders, and that will surely create a better future for the Muslim Ummah. With that, I end. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Before I pass the mic to Dr. Mazli, perhaps as an academic who has been teaching in the universities for 25 years, the students that we face every day, and one of the criteria that we can identify whether these students are leaders or not, that they can become a leader in the future, is to see in front of us what we can see those who become leaders in that sense. Another thing, one of the examples is to appoint a class rep. We call it ketua class. One of the good examples. And in one class, nobody would like to volunteer and nobody would like to nominate anyone. So the lecturer has to appoint one of the boys to become the class rep. And this does not show a good remark. But in some places, you can see there are so many hands and they can't solve this problem. I think I take some points of what Dr. Azman mentioned about this the Muslim problem with regard to backwards and ineffective. I would share just before, just a couple of minutes before I pass to Dr. Mazli. It reminds me when I was studying in London, one of the transport that I normally took to source from my place, it takes about 45 minutes from my door to door, from my place to my campus. And sometimes I took this double-decker bus, and it's from Ilford to Russell Square. So along the way, it passed by what we call it, if you're very familiar with London, is Whitechapel Mosque. And this Bangladeshi, if there is Bangladeshi here, this Bangladeshi wearing a ketayab, look very religious, sit next to me. I wonder what he's doing. That day was on Wednesday. So he was writing something. So I just, what he's doing? He was writing numbers. What numbers? You bear in mind, Wednesday evening and Saturday evening, what are so special in London? That is the result of Lotto, or what we call the Toto. During our time, when I was small, we have Toto Life telecast. You ask, in Malaysia, you young people, you didn't experience this. It's only appeared in just half an hour live telecast of Toto result, and then the station closed and replayed back by six. And then suddenly, he pressed the bell. He went off. And so where he went to the Whitechapel Mosque. So this is something quite interesting, with the ketayab, with very religious appearance, having that, and then went to up to the mosque. And I think we will listen to Dr. Mazli to share with what Dr. Hazman has shared with us. I think after that we have the opportunity for others to share. Dr. Mazli? Yeah.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin wa bihi nasta'in. Thank you very much Dr. Azam, our presenter, Dr. Azman, brothers and sisters. You know, it's very interesting when Dr. Azman mentioned the hadith of kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'ulun an ra'iyatihi. We have been taught by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that every single individual, every single Muslim individuals are indeed leaders, and they'll be accountable. They'll be questioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the day hereafter of their ra'iyah, of their sheep. We were taught we are the shepherds. The Christians, they're living with the spirit of becoming the sheep of the shepherd. They believe that Jesus is the shepherd. But it's very ironic to see that in nowadays world that they are in fact the shepherd and we became the sheep. So I think there is something wrong with the way Muslim thinks and the way we look at life itself. I mean, it's not only thinking of becoming a shepherd, but it's rather the winner mentality that they're living with. Definitely we wouldn't agree with the idea of superiority of certain races, certain people, ethnicity. But again, for the Western world, that you keep iterating, or you keep using the word Western there, they've been living with that since, ever since the time of Aristotle. We've read Plato's Republic, or even Aristotle Politics. They were talking about civitas, about how the Greek people, they have the civitas, whereas the non-Greek people, they are the barbarians. Yeah. So that spirit lived within them, even though they were experiencing the dark ages. So when they managed to break free from religion, from the churches, I'm sorry, they managed to regain back the idea of civitas and feel the burden of becoming the shepherd to the sheep all around the world. And it's very unfortunate that we Muslims, we have been taught in Quran as Khairul Ummah, we have been taught by Prophet Muhammad to be the shepherd, Ra'in, but we don't have that winner mentality, the civitas. I don't know what went wrong, but I still remember, I do strongly remember what Iqbal told us, Allamah Iqbal, when he said, I mean, actually he was not mimicking. I mean, he was trying to be cynistic. I mean, to be sarcastic of the West, the Westerner wannabe, or what we say as the woke, Western-oriented gentleman, which reflects the coconuts or the bananas. You know, coconuts, bananas. No, brown outside, white inside. He said that, okay, look here, he said, what Allama Iqbal said, when the Western people drink wine, we also drink wine. They got drunk, but they develop. We got drunk, we don't develop. It is not about the wine. It is not about the glass, but it's the way how we drink the wine. I don't know whether you get what he meant. Paham pak, bapak paham lah. So, yes, we could theorize about leadership. We could go to any good literatures on leadership, good motivational books on leadership. But when it comes to political leadership in Malaysia, it requires a different ball game. I mean, whatever causes and Posner's talk, or whatever Tariq Sridan or Dr. Azman has written, it doesn't apply in the way we look at leadership in Malaysia. Because in Malaysia, especially among Muslims, among Malays, leadership is all about the ability to convince others. Especially the ability of convince others to believe in your lies. No. The ability of convince yourself of your own lies. And number two, it is the ability to manipulate others. It's either by your charismatic, it's either by your oratory skill, or in many cases, by using money. I mean, that's the reality of our community. It's very sad. It's very unfortunate. Or sometimes you may not have money, but you have religion. You can make use of religion in order to manipulate others. You can sell heaven. If you don't buy heaven, they go to hell. I mean, we're just replicating what had been done by the Cesario Paparian age of the Christian, of the West. Or sometimes, if we couldn't offer religion, we don't have enough money, we can offer protection. Mau bayar sama ayah anda. Okay. It's all about leadership in Malay community. But definitely we're not going to talk about that. We're going to focus on your book. That's only my introduction. No, not really. I mean, I'm just being sarcastic as usual. Okay, looking at Dr. Azman's book, I mean, I really encourage you guys to buy the book. But anyway, I mean, what I've prepared, after going through the book, I'm very lucky. Because the organizer, they gave me the book and they did not take it back. Unlike Dr. Azam, was very unfortunate. Okay, I've gone through it, okay, twice. But, you know, sometimes being an academic, we are fully occupied with, you know, it's short semester, so we are catching the KPIs. Oh, journal articles, these articles here and there, research, I don't know, everything in the pipeline, we're trying to push everything to finish it. So I've gone through twice, but, you know, speed reading. I don't really know what I really grasp from it, but I've written some, comments and, constructive criticism on it. Okay, number one, You know, looking at any MSG alumni, the 80s and 90s generation, they're very typical Tariq Swaidanian. Especially a guy by the name of Azman Hussein. Okay. Tariq Swaidanian, one thing. Number two, they're very okay, no, I don't need to mention about that. Maybe younger generation, you did not experience this. But you should learn from the elders. I mean, you should ask them. There should be experience sharing session, and learning the history. I mean, I told Dr. Azman just now that I'm now currently finishing a book on this mafia group in Malaysia called, initially they were known as IRC, then they metamorphosized to JIM, and now they emerge into a new form called IKRAM. So it's a tough thing finishing that book, because after conducting how many hundred interviews, including the one with Dr. Azman, but I keep meeting with all new information, and a lot of these informations, I mean, it's the same information, but a little bit from everywhere. You have to bear yourself to put into, the puzzles to get the bigger picture. So I really admire some of people who could easily writing the history of what they call as the infiltration of IRC or JIM into certain organization. I really admire them. How professional or unprofessional they are in writing history. So I told Dr. Azman that, yes, the story about IRC is not that difficult. Abundance, if not tons, of literatures dealing with them. Especially the most monumental one that been written by Zaina Anwar. And then what been written by Chandra Muzaffar and by Hamisa. But when I tried to find any literatures dealing with MISG, I found null. None. I hope I'll be the first person to write it. Before you guys. Okay. Excuse me. Dia makan ni, dia makan benda apa tu, pulut dia jadi angin. Sedap seri muka dia tadi. Okay, so looking back at MISG, you just couldn't separate MISG from Tariq Swaidan in the 90s. Tariq Swaidan was, they are murabbis in the 80s, Tariq Swaidan, the people, the guy there. Yeah, with Shimav. He was the sheikh or murabbi of the MISG, students then. So, looking at this book, is very Tariq Swaidanian. You go to any Tariq Swaidan book, you can feel the aroma of Swaidanian in this book. Okay, if you don't have the book, please buy a copy of it. Grab yourself a copy of it. Okay, and it's a motivational book. But it's different. This motivational book, unlike other, by using the word that being used by Dr. Azman, Western, produced by the Westerners, this book, sometimes it really puzzles you. It's a motivational book, but at the same time, when you go through, when you flip page by page, you found out that you ended up reading a religious book. Every single page is full of quotation from Quran, verses of Quran, hadith, or certain quotation from Khalifa, from Khulafa, and a lot of quotation from Ulama. So you're kind of asking yourself, am I reading a religious book, or am I reading a motivational book, or I am reading both? I could conclude that it is both. It is both. Because the thing that I got whenever I go through every pages is just like reading a new kind of, in academics we call it emergentism method of doing things. It's a kind of presenting a whole new idea in a whole new Okay. So, but another thing, after finish reading it for the first and the second time, I found out it's not only a motivational book. It is not only a religious book. It reminds me of another genre of academic writing. It is a biography of Prophet Muhammad SAW himself. It is a new way of representing the sirah of the Prophet Muhammad SAW. Yes, it's true, just like Dr. Azman said a couple of minutes ago, that Rasulullah ﷺ has all the leadership quality in himself, in one person. It just reminds me of the late Allama Al-Buti. In his Fiqh Sirah, in his Muqaddimah, the introduction of his book, he said that Prophet Muhammad was an example or is an icon for a lot of people. He is an icon for teachers, for fathers, for leaders, for army generals, for political leaders, for traders. And talking about traders, it just remind me of two monumental books dealing with Prophet Muhammad SAW, where the authors of these two books adamantly say that the capitalism economic system was not emerged with Adam Smith. He was not the founder of the capitalism system. But indeed, it was Prophet Muhammad SAW. Yep. Okay. The first one was the French Maxime Rodinson in his book, Islam and Capitalism. And the second one was rather new, that was published last year by a German writer named Benedict Kohler, Islam and the Birth of Capitalism. Both of these authors adamantly said that the idea of having, actually he was not talking about capitalism as being understood by the socialists and being distorted its picture by the socialists and being imported by us without critically analyzing it and looking at capitalism as something evil. For them, it's about free market economy, it's about liberal economy, it's about, minimizing the state and leaving a big space for the society with its dynamism to emerge and leaving the economy to the market. He said, both of them said, the idea of market economy actually was inspired or was first brought by Prophet Muhammad SAW. So, coming back to Sayyid Ramadan Abuti, he said that Rasulullah is an example for everybody. But unfortunately, when we read his seerah, when we read his book, he did not manage to come up with that. He just followed the very, typical method of the seerah writing, starting with the birth of Prophet Muhammad, and then he received the revelation and all the tribulation in Mecca, migration to Medina, all the wars and battles, and ended up with the death of Prophet Muhammad SAW and his funeral and etc. So that was a typical and normal method in writing the seerah of Prophet Muhammad SAW. And you just couldn't find how in the world could we learn that Prophet Muhammad is an example for traders, for teachers, for armies, for country leaders, for statesmen, and etc. But when I look at this book that been written by MISG alumni, led by Dr. Azman and his patron, Tariq Suaidan, I found this is the answer. This is the answer for my thirst, or it's just like it's quenching my thirst. I've been waiting for it since 30 years ago. Because I was introduced to Sayyid Ramadan Al-Buti's Fiqh Sirah, 30 years ago. I'm not that old. I'm not 30 yet, anyway. Okay.
But now I said, okay, this is the book. The way to look at Rasulullah as an example in leadership. In leadership. So I would say that this is a fresh look at Sirah Nabawiyah. This book is not only a motivational book, it is not only a religious book, but it is first and foremost a fresh look into Sirah Nabawiyah. I don't know how could you simplify it to laymen. I mean, has it been translated to Bahasa?
Not yet.
You should translate it into Bahasa Melayu. You should translate it. And if possible, get some teachers, sekolah menengah teachers or sekolah rendah teachers, to simplify it, to build a leadership talents among our younger generation. Betul lah, macam, it's totally right what, it's totally true what Dr. Azam said. You were talking about campus classes. But look at the sekolah menengah and sekolah rendah class, the same thing. Because we were not taught of leadership. We were not nurtured in our classroom to become leaders. We only being projected and be programmed to get A's. And it's very unfortunate if you look at our school children, they've been divided by numbers and grades. This is class A because they got better grade, they get best grade. This is class B because they got better grade. This is class C, they only got average grade. And this is class D because they're stupid. And it kills the dynamism of the students. He said, oh, okay, at the end of the day, I'm D class student. Since year one, year two, year three, I'm D. That's it. You kill the leadership within. You kill the potential within. You kill the big leader within that guy. I mean, not everybody, not all leaders score A's, especially in Malaysia. And not all those who get good CGPA are smart and wise and good leaders. They might end up being jokers or clowns in the cabinet. Okay. So, I mean, looking at this book, I really hope that this book will not stop here. It should be translated, it should be simplified, and it should be conveyed to our younger generation. We need to create leaders since sekolah rendah, since the primary school. No, I'm wrong. We should create leaders since kindergarten phase. I mean, that is why if you go to, Dr. Azam has experienced in the UK, you go to any primary school in any developed countries, you find that they don't have examination until year six. No examination at all. It's all about characteristic building. Leadership, talent, you know, thinking skill, critical thinking, dynamism, soft skills, communication skill, respect, all those things. That was the formative years. So I really hope that this book could be translated into sekolah rendah or even sekolah tadika readings. It helped a lot. You create a whole new generation, you will create a revolution with this book. Believe me, inshallah. And also, I mean, we also need not only a book on leadership of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we also need to dig a lot on other qualities in the life of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I mean, a lot of other books should be written on politics, humanity, ethics, and love. So, we should put an end to a very primitive way in looking at Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You know, sometimes I always make this joke, and I mean, I have to advertise my book. Can I advertise my book here instead of only your book? Okay. Now, actually, I brought with me my book, Pemuda Islam, Risalah Pemuda Islam, where I put my picture there. And, you know, the topic is Risalah Pemuda Islam, but you find out a picture of a not really young person there, not really young guy there, not wearing any serban or jubah or whatever. And I told it, and I, when I was asked, why are you taking your picture and put it there when you have that Risalah Pemuda Muslim? I said, because I want to promote sunnah. Ah, people said, sunnah, how come sunnah? You're wearing only, I mean, a shirt and trousers and pants, and you not even have a skull cap. Tak pakai kupiah pun. How can it be sunnah? Okay, you have a little beard anyway, but it's not enough to be called sunnah. Yeah, it should be this long or certain centimeters long, or, you know. I said, this is sunnah. This is sunnah. Because Rasulullah SAW is not about the jubah, it's not about the robe that he wear, but it's about being presentable. If you read Zadul Ma'ad, a book that was written by Ibn Qayyim Jauziyah in volume 4, I mean, when he deal with Hadi Muhammad SAW, Hadi Rasulullah SAW, fil libas, his guidance in terms of attirement, he said that Rasulullah SAW was a versatile kind of person. He wear any dress that suitable with occasion. I mean, sometimes he put on burdul yamani, sometimes he put jubbah, sometimes he put, but he has a preference in terms of color. He prefers white. That is very definite. But one most important thing is, he always look presentable. And he always up to date with the latest fashion of the day. The latest fad du jour of the day. So, I mean, and also, you know, talking about writing the Sirah of Prophet Muhammad, another dimension of Sirah of Prophet Muhammad that we should also emphasize on is the preservation of environment. Osman Bakar, Professor Osman Bakar, yeah, the Sith before you, who was there. You know the word Sith? None of you are the big fan of Star Wars anyway. Okay, so, I mean, the deputy director of, that Sith, Darth Vader. Okay, so, apa tu? The Prophet Osman Bakar did write a lot of pieces, treaties dealing with environment. But again, we would like to see environment, the preservation of environment from the life of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But it will require a huge effort in looking into a hadith. Dr. Azman is very lucky because in leadership, you just only need to refer not to all book of hadith. In your book, you did mention that you refer a lot to Ar-Rahiq al-Maktum by Al-Mubarak Furi. I think because that's the only book available translated in English of Sirah Nabawiyah. Yeah? Ibn Ishaq. Yeah, and Ibn Ishaq. And one good thing about Mubarak Furi, apart from being a Sirah scholar, is also a hadith scholar. So, you know, the method of hadith scholars in accepting riwayah or stories related to Prophet Muhammad, I mean, is more meticulous and more particular, because they did not accept, especially any riwayat from Ibn Ishaq. Some controversial riwayat of Ibn Ishaq, Mubarak Furi did not include in his Ar-Rahiq al-Maktum. So this book, I would recognize a very recommendable book, because it did not include a lot of, you know, fabricated stories, and also, weak narrated stories about Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that unfortunately you might find a lot in Ibn Ishaq and Ibn Hisham. So it's a good thing to refer to Ar-Rahiq al-Maktum. Okay, that's number two. And number three, kita dah habis, huh? Well, sorry, I'm boring you guys. Okay. The way the book is trying to present Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in terms of leadership, actually is part of what being known as the multiple modernities approach. You know, when you talk about the current modern world, when all the Western peoples came out with all the latest idea on leadership, on motivation, on organization, management, and etc. It has to do with the idea of modernity. The way of doing things must be according to idea of modernity. So that is why you find Hofstede, who trying to challenge the idea of modernity by saying that no, it's enough with the conventional way of management. Let's look to other culture. So that's how Hofstede, instead of looking into the Western culture, he said, let's look at Confucianism. And he tried to compare between Confucianism idea of management, Confucianism idea of, working ethics. He tried to compare it with Western. With that, he managed to challenge the very idea of Max Weber. Because Max Weber, in his book, The Ethics of Protestantism, he tried to say that why Western community, why Western societies, by the way, Max Weber was the second father of sociology after Ibn Khaldun, of modern sociology, why the Western countries develop, Western societies develop in compared to the Eastern community and etc. He said because of the ethics of Protestantism. And for him, he just referring to he refer a lot to his Calvinism moral values. But Hofstede challenged that. He said no. Even in Confucianism, there are a lot of values that could push the Eastern societies to develop. And actually, he was based on the emergence of the dragons of the East, the tigers of the East. He said, what is the secret recipes of the development of these Eastern countries like Hong Kong, like Taiwan, like Korea, like Japan? He said, it has to do with the Confucianism spirit. So, the idea of multiple modernities is trying to celebrate the diversity, trying to celebrate the values that exist in different societies. It's trying to challenge the idea of modernity that's saying that there are a certain meta-narrative that should be followed by the people of the world if they want to develop, if they want to be excellent in their life. So this book, what we have now, is fallen under the method of multiple modernities. And we should engage furthermore with it. It's not only in the field of leadership, just like I mentioned earlier, we should also explore the other fields of life. A lot of things you could learn from Prophet Muhammad SAW and from the Quran itself. Okay, a lot. And number four, I think number four. Okay, this is my not my critics, but it's more on my suggestion how we could improve this book, because it's a kind of motivational book. So sometimes motivational books, there are certain things that there's certain patterns that normally people follow. Number one is, I mean, you could be more creative in making it more reader friendly. And because this book, I'm sure not all readers would be could bear themselves reading it. I mean, for religious books lovers like us, or most of us, we could bear with it until the end of the page. But not everybody could go for it. So there are certain, let me say, certain style of writings in motivational books, especially talking about leadership, management, and etc. Maybe we could expect more diagrams, perhaps, in the future, because you find a lot of Quranic verses and a lot of hadith being put in small boxes, you know, pop-up boxes there, but lack of diagrams. I think diagrams help a lot to help or to assist the readers to understand more about your ideas. And number two is checklist. I think what we found after at the end of every chapters, there's no checklist of what we have learned from the book and what we should do next. Action plan. A normal motivational book, you find that at the end of every chapters or end of every segment. Said, oh, after reading these chapters, I will, number one, number two. Or after reading these chapters, well, and another thing is the case studies. You know, we could bring some real cases and try to reflect it with the theoretical framework that we brought or with the ideas that we presented. Okay, reflections. Reflections is very important. After we read every chapters or every segment, try to make the readers personalize what they have read to themselves. And it could come with reflections and also real life examples. You know, sometimes when we read motivational books, it's always about stories. Dale Carnegie, I mean, he has tons of stories to share with us. Because in most of the cases, with all these stories, we could relate ourselves to the idea and to the bigger picture of what the author is trying to present. Apart from that, I think that's all for me. And thank you very much. And sorry to boring you guys. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.